Remember Will Mortensen? He's the freshman lawmaker who introduces articles of impeachment against Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg. Well, days after the House panel votes against impeachment, Mortensen, who's an attorney, notices something.
When I read the report, and I read it carefully and a few times, some of the legal conclusions I just disagreed with. They referenced a clear and convincing evidence standard. And in the legal world, I mean, that's some legal mumbo jumbo to most people. What it means is you got to find this very high threshold.
Mortensen, a Republican, thinks the House panel's approach is wrong in this first ever impeachment process for a state official. He focuses on the legal threshold for proof of wrongdoing. While it's not a perfect metaphor, Mortensen says think of the clear and convincing level as evidence that suggests a 75% certainty the crime was committed. Mortensen says the impeachment panel is applying a criminal law threshold to the political question of impeachment. He says they have it backwards.
And while that may be appropriate in the Senate, I don't know. It's clearly not appropriate for coming out of the House to the Senate for a trial. And so on some of those more legal matters, I just thought they construed impeachment too narrowly and set some standards I didn't agree with.
The House impeachment panel relies on a decades-old state Supreme Court case to define its legal threshold for impeachment. Tyler Moore is a professor at the USD School of Law. He says the precedent-setting case involves statutory removal of a county official rather than the removal of a constitutional officer. A trial court judge hears the case against the Gregory County Register of Deeds, who is accused of taking taxpayer money.
In this case, the trial judge said no, he shouldn't be convicted because we don't have clear and convincing evidence. So the House used that standard of review from this trial court applied.
Moore says the state Supreme Court ruling sets a precedent. The clear and convincing standard applies to the statutory removal in the courts. The Republican majority House panel applies the same standard for its impeachment investigation.
Which sounds maybe reasonable at first. I think if you dig into it very much at all, though, I think it's less reasonable. Again, first of all, we're talking about the Gregory County Register of Deeds, not the Attorney General.
Moore says the state's impeachment process already requires a higher standard, with each chamber casting votes. In the House, impeachment requires a simple majority vote. In the Senate, it's two-thirds. Also, all 105 legislators weigh in on impeachment versus just a single trial court judge. In addition to questions about the legal precedent for standards of impeachment, there's also another challenge thrown into the process. It turns out the House panel has come to its conclusion without fully hearing from a key agency involved in the investigation. I'm Lee Strubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk, a look at the arc of one political career, the events of a dark night, and the political consequences. An email to the state press corps arrives a few days after the House panel recommends against Ravnsborg's impeachment. The State Department of Public Safety announces a public briefing for legislators about the fatal crash. In a recorded phone call, Speaker of the House Spencer Gosch, leader of the impeachment panel, balks at the move.
I mean, look, we can't stop them from giving a presentation, right? But I think it does raise some of the concerns, especially from some of the committee members, as to, are they biased? You know, what is the push? You know, why are they pushing for impeachment, you know, when they're supposed to be an unbiased investigative committee or investigative entity, right? So I think there's some of those concerns. You know, why are they pushing for impeachment? I thought their job was to investigate.
I follow up saying the press release says House lawmakers requested the briefing. Gosch says he doesn't buy it.
Yeah, the only thing I've heard from lawmakers is they want to know who requested it because they don't know. And I've heard that from quite a few lawmakers. They don't know of any lawmakers that requested it. So they just want to know who those individuals are, if that's what they're going to say.
I requested that the Higher Patrol give us a briefing.
That's Republican Representative Tim Goodwin. He's dissatisfied with the report issued by the House panel. With such a large investigation file and quick turnaround time to vote, Goodwin says he wants to hear directly from the agency that pieced the crash scene together.
They went through, I can't remember how long it was, I'd say an hour, hour and 10 minutes, and they laid out the most professional briefing I've ever seen.
And so a handful of reporters returned to peer, along with a few members of the public. 3 House lawmakers show up in person. The rest attend online. As it turns out, the briefing includes information never presented to the impeachment panel. Troopers John Burnt and Kevin Kinney, who we've heard from in prior episodes, outline key aspects of the investigation. They start with the moment immediately after the crash.
After impact, Attorney General Ravnsborg stops approximately 614 feet after impact. If Attorney General Ravnsborg hits something and stops and does what would be referred to as a panic brake, from 68 miles an hour, he would actually stop in 174 feet. And that is an exact number based on the testing that we did with Attorney General Ravnsborg's vehicle. So it took him over 3 times the normal distance to stop.
That extended stop is not mentioned in the impeachment panel's report. Also missing in the report is the trooper's conclusion that pedestrians along that stretch of road would be clearly visible. They test that with an agent walking along the road at night.
They saw him. At one point, one vehicle actually came to check on Agent Rummel as he was walking. Because we were not there with amber lights on, we didn't have patrol vehicles in the area. We had Agent Rummel walking on the shoulder of the roadway. Our patrol vehicles were parked in the Highmore DOT yard. So people driving just saw a pedestrian walking and were able to see him stop and check on him.
Also missing from the impeachment panel's report is what the troopers call Ravnsborg's shifting story about the crash and following events. The panel reports Ravnsborg may have simply misspoke. Sergeant Kevin Kinney says a shifting story can add time and resources to investigations.
Sometimes the length of our investigation depends on how forthcoming the people that we're looking into are with the information that we need to make sure we're completing a thorough investigation. And so when somebody's not forthcoming with that information, it does take us longer because we're out looking for the facts to make sure that we present a whole case.
After about an hour, the troopers wrap up their presentation, saying they've shared information that members of the impeachment panel never heard. One state lawmaker asks why. Trooper Kevin Kinney responds.
So we had prepared this same exact presentation for the House Select Committee. And when we got there, we were advised that they had read all of our reports and they were going to ask us the questions that they had. And so we weren't allowed to give the presentation or the overview of what our investigation entailed. We were only allowed to answer the questions that they had in regards to Attorney General Ravnsborg's crash.
The House impeachment panel's report casts doubt on the investigation by these two troopers, saying the location of the crash is in dispute. Sergeant Kinney says the totality of the evidence suggests that the crash happened on the edge of the highway's shoulder.
You cannot take pieces and components out that you don't like or don't want to look at and ignore those.
The troopers are asked one final question, which is whether they believe Ravnsborg was distracted while he was driving. Trooper Burnt answers the question with questions that summarize their investigation.
How do you explain somebody's face coming through your windshield, their glasses coming into your car, a significant amount of glass coming inside of the vehicle, that person staying on your vehicle for approximately a second and being that far onto the shoulder, then stopping 600 feet, which is 3 times the normal stopping distance, other than saying that they were distracted?
When asked how certain they are in their investigation findings, the troopers say beyond a reasonable doubt. When the presentation is over, lawmakers in the room react to what they've heard. That includes Representative Mortensen.
The most disappointing thing that I heard today was that these troopers, who put together a very professional and on the merits investigation, offered to present it to that committee and were denied that opportunity. I think that if you're ever putting a muzzle on law enforcement, you're doing the wrong thing. And in this case, more information, especially from experts as qualified as these troopers, would have only helped the committee. That was the most disappointing thing I heard today.
In less than a week, House lawmakers will convene for a vote on the impeachment panel's report. But some, like Representative Mortensen, have other ideas. And after a break, the man in the spotlight, Jason Ravnsborg, finally makes his case to lawmakers.
Short Walk is made possible with your Friends of SDPB membership and by the support of Explore South Dakota Fund. Corporate support for Short Walk comes from Turback Law Office in Watertown, attorneys handling insurance and personal injury claims. More at turbacklaw.com. For regular updates on all the news around the state, subscribe to The Morning Report, delivered twice a week to your inbox. We also produce a daily news podcast. You can find out more information about both at sdpb.org/news.
I'm Lee Strubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk, the story of a political career, a fatal crash, and the consequences. The day before House lawmakers are scheduled to meet, I obtain an email chain that includes every member of the House of Representatives. In it, Representative Mortensen says he intends to reintroduce his articles of impeachment despite the panel's recommendation against it. He calls it the most difficult topic he's ever considered. A few lawmakers debate, even oppose Mortensen's proposal. Later that night, House lawmakers receive another email, this one from Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg, a man who's been given every available opportunity to speak before the House impeachment panel. The 7-page document is an attempt to convince House lawmakers not to impeach him. Ravnsborg expresses his deep sympathy to the Beaver family and says he's done so publicly and privately. He says the impeachment panel is about more than just an accident, saying it was immediately seized and politically weaponized by the governor. Ravnsborg says the incident does not impede his ability to do his job. He argues the governor should never have involved herself in impeachment, given his investigations into her office. He pushes against what he calls misconceptions in the case. The letter ends with this quote. It's been 576 days since the accident. I mark it on my calendar each day and reflect. I want to say I'm sorry. Every day I think about Joe Beaver, a man I had never met, who changed my life forever. I am sorry the family has had to endure this tragedy in so many ways and has been put in the middle of this highly political situation. House lawmakers meet the next day, and Republicans caucus behind closed doors for more than an hour. When they return, they're reserved and move quickly to the impeachment question. But they do not vote on whether to adopt the panel's report against impeachment. Instead, Representative Mortensen moves his impeachment articles.
The Attorney General has broken the law, and as a result of that, one of our citizens has died. Our top law enforcement officer has misled law enforcement during the investigation of those crimes. Never before in our state's history has it been that a state official criminally ended the life of one of our citizens and refused to resign from that post. This is a grave and exceptional situation.
Mortensen says the Constitution gives House lawmakers broad discretion to impeach, and they should not take it lightly.
I have a lot of reverence for this institution and for this House. I think a lot about its past, and I think a lot about its future. It is undeniable that there is a precedent being set today. I want everybody to understand that before we vote on this. What we do affects not only today and not only the folks involved, it will affect folks in the future.
Mortensen outlines the first of his two impeachment articles. He says firmly established facts support the crimes leading to the death of Joe Beaver. The Attorney General has admitted to one of those facts, pleading guilty to a lane infraction.
Why is that important? Joe Beaver was standing where he had every right to be, doing what he had every right to be doing. He was walking home.
Mortensen says he takes the Attorney General at his word when he claims he did not see the pedestrian before he hit him. He says that means Ravnsborg was distracted when he hit Joe Beaver.
If he were looking, if he were not distracted, he would have seen the man.
If you think he saw the man and that he was paying attention and that he was not distracted, then we're talking about a far more serious crime. I'm not alleging that crime at this time. I'm merely saying his attention was not where it had ought to have been on the road.
Mortensen says the circumstances of the case show a troubling pattern of behavior and that House members should impeach the Attorney General and send the articles to the Senate for a full trial. As Mortensen sits down, Democratic Representative Ryan Schwach stands up to present the second article of impeachment. Schwach was one of the two members of the House panel who said Ravnsborg should be impeached. Those two relatively young lawmakers are working across the aisle to impeach the state's top law enforcement officer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Fellow representatives, I ask you to join me in concluding that the Attorney General committed malfeasance in office that warrants a trial for consideration of his removal in the Senate.
Schwach says he's come to that determination for three reasons. First, a misleading press release sent by the Attorney General days after the crash. Second, Ravnsborg's interaction with cell phones forensic expert Special Agent Brent Gromer. And third, the testimony by law enforcement concerning his answers and behaviors during their interrogations. Schwach says people have a duty to be honest, especially those who hold a position of public trust. He says Ravnsborg refuses to confirm what he hit when asked.
Now, this is an important question for the dispatcher to get a truthful answer. In particular, it allows the dispatcher to determine if, among other things, an ambulance needs to be sent to the scene.
In addition to misleading dispatchers, Schwach says Ravnsborg misleads the public in his official press release by saying the accident occurred in the roadway.
We now know this is not true, and the Attorney General pled no contest to a lane violation charge.
Schwach says Ravnsborg abused his position by questioning a cell phone forensics expert in his office less than 72 hours after the accident.
The Attorney General used the privileges of his office to learn about how the investigation would be conducted. The average suspect would not be able to learn the techniques of those investigating him, and I submit to you that that is wrong, that that is malfeasance, that he had a duty to completely wall himself from the investigation, including the people in his office.
Schwach reminds lawmakers how Ravnsborg's forthcomingness with investigators about his cell phone use changes over time. Schwach refers to Ravnsborg's animated body language during the interrogation, and investigators who say his recollection of the night's event is too inconsistent with the facts to be believable. Schwach says this constitutes malfeasance in office and calls for impeachment. Five other House members stand up and say Ravnsborg should be impeached. None speak in favor of Ravnsborg. And no member of the impeachment panel stands up to defend their work. And so comes a first-ever vote of its kind, whether the South Dakota House of Representatives should impeach a sitting constitutional officer. Lawmakers take about 1 minute, and then...
Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
Please display the vote.
That's next time on Short Walk. I'm Lee Strubinger. I wrote, reported, and produced this episode. Kate Smith edited the script. Josh Chilson is our news director. Kara Hetland, our director of journalism. Twyla Olson is our director of content. SDPB's executive director is Julie Overgaard. Thanks to Matt LaChoix and Flower Room Records, who created the show's music. Special thanks to the South Dakota Press Corps, representing various organizations who provided dedicated coverage of this story along the way, including Stephen Groves, Christopher Vondrachik, Joe Sneeby, Austin Goss, Ariel Zions, Patrick Callahan, Abby Wargo, Joshua Heyer, Jonathan Ellis, Jackie Hendry, Seth Tupper, and Bob Mercer. Be sure to check out more at sdpb.org/shortwalk. Please rate and review the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. Join me for the next episode of Short Walk.